Hello, in this video I'm going to show you how to derive subcatchments and add different parameters to the attribute table, such as the mean slope, the surface area, and the maximum flow length. For this video, I assume that you have installed the PCRaster Tools plugin. We'll use several tools from the plugin. I'm also assuming that you have watched previous videos on streaming catchment delineation using the PCRaster Tools plugin. Let's start with deriving the slope raster. Choose from the raster menu, Analysis, Slope. Choose your DEM as input layer and make sure that it's not in the geographic coordinate system. You can check this box if you want to have the slope expressed in percent instead of degrees. Call the output slope degrees.diff because here we keep the defaults. Click Run. After completion, click Close. So let's now delineate subcatchments. To delineate subcatchments, I need to look for junctions in the delineated stream network. And the best way to do that is to use the channel strata layer that we've created in another video. I'll give it some random colors so we can easily recognize the different tributaries. And I uncheck the river vector layer. And here we see a junction. And if I click right, I can copy the coordinate. And then I paste it in Notepad. And I add comma one. So it is X comma Y comma ID number. And those ID numbers will be used later to assign to the derived subcatchments. Let's do another one. And I simply create this comma separated values file with different coordinates and ID numbers. So each row is an outlet with their unique ID number. But now I've got four outlets. I save it as outlets.txt. Then I go to the processing toolbox and I'm going to use column file to PC raster map. With this tool, I can convert coordinates in a comma separated values file to a raster using a raster mask layer. I set the output data type to nominal and I save the result as outlets.map in the PC raster format. Click Run. Close the dialog and style the result using paletted unique values. And here we see with random colors the junctions. After deriving these outlets and having them as a raster layer in our map canvas, I can use the subcatchment tool to derive the subcatchments related to these outlets. Choose flow direction as local drain direction layer. Choose outlets as the outlet layer and save the result as subcatchments.map. Click Run. Here's the result. Now we can style it with the same colors as our outlets because each pixel in our subcatchment has the same value as its outlet ID. And here we see our four subcatchments. Now this is still in the raster format and it would also be good to have the subcatchment boundaries as polygons. So I go to the raster menu, conversion, polygonize raster to vector. As an input I use my subcatchments. I can change the name of the field to create and I change it to ID so it corresponds with the pixel values which are the ID numbers of the catchments. And then I save the result. And here I'll save this to a shapefile. And I call it subcatchments. Save and run. Close the dialog and here you see the result. I can select these catchments And if I open the attribute table, you'll see that there's many more polygons, but let's select one and zoom to this selected polygon, and you'll see that that is an artifact of the factorization of the raster. So by selecting the polygons and inverting the selection, I can now delete the selection and get rid of everything that's not a subcatchment. Toggle off editing and save the result. Now we can use these subcatchment polygons with zonal statistics to derive their average slope. So I use subcatchments as input layer and the slope degrees raster layer as the raster layer. I change the output column prefix to slope so I can recognize it later because we're going to add some other columns. And I want the statistic mean to be calculated. And then it will be stored in the column slope underscore mean. And I will save the result to a geo package. And I give it the name subcatchment slope. Run. And check the result. And here we see the mean slopes for each subcatchment. We can sort it by using the arrow. Next, I want to calculate the areas of each subcatchment, and I'll do this in the field calculator. I create a new output field with the name area square meters. I change the output field type to decimal number. And then I use a geometry function called $area. If I double click, it will be added, and this will calculate the surface area in square meters. So now we have that field added to our attribute table. Move off editing and save the result. Next, I would like to add the maximum flow path of each subcatchment to the attribute table. So first we need to calculate the length of flow paths. I use the ldddist tool. I need to specify the local drain direction, and I need a layer, which is Boolean, with cells to which the distance is calculated, and a friction layer. So let's first prepare those layers that we don't have yet. So remember that our outlets layer is a nominal data type, and we need a Boolean for the ldddist tool. So I'm going to convert the data type of outlets to Boolean. And I name the result outlets Boolean. Let's check the result by styling it using the paletted unique values renderer. When I click classify, I see there's only value 1 in this raster layer. Let's give it a color. And here we see our red outlet pixel. And the rest is transparent because it's no data. However, the ldddist tool needs zeros and ones, so I want to add zeros. Therefore, I'm going to use the spatial tool to create a raster with zero Boolean values. And I call this layer Boolean 0. Click run. This raster only has Boolean 0 values. Now I want to combine outlets Boolean and then substitute every no data pixel with Boolean 0. So here the red dots are 1 and the black are 0, and I want to combine this. And I can do that with the cover tool. The cover tool takes an input raster, which has some values but also missing data. So I choose outlets Boolean, and then I can select here layers that I want to use in that order to substitute the no data, and here I only substitute it with the Boolean 0 values. I'll save the result as outlets true false. Click run. Let's move it to the top and style it again with paletted unique values. And here we see we have zeros and ones, and you can see the pixels that have value 1, which are still our outlet pixels. Now I need the friction layer, which is just value 1 in scalar format. and I save the result. Painter 1. This raster has only scalar 1 values. And now we have all the inputs for the ldddist tool. The ldd is the flow direction layer. Cells to which the distance is calculated is the outlet's true false boolean layer. And the friction layer is the just created scalar 1 layer. I'll save the result as drainageDistance.map. And here we go. Here's the result. Let's style it. We use single mem pseudocolor because it's a continuous raster, it's a scalar. And I use a color ramp here from white to red. And now I can calculate with zonal statistics again the maximum value in each subcatchment and add it to the attribute table. So let's go to zonal statistics. The input layer is the previous zonal statistics result that we had, so with the slope. So we can add this column, and I use the output column prefix. With the name flow length. And in this case, I want the maximum value of the drainage distance raster. Save the result to the geo package. And I give the name subcatchments, slope, and flow path. Click OK and run. Let's check the attribute table. And here we have the three variables of the subcatchments, the mean slope, the surface area, and the maximum flow length. And we can sort it by clicking on the header. That's nice, such a table, but it would also be nice to visualize this longest flow path in each subcatchment. So let's see if we can do that. I would need the path tool, which will give the path over the local drain direction network downstream to its pit. It needs the LDD and it needs a points raster layer. Now these points are the maximum drainage distances. And with the area operations, I can do zonal operations with the PCRaster tools. And as class, I use the subcatchment raster. And I want to know the maximum value in the drainage distance raster per subcatchment. And I'll save the result to max flow path. So now every subcatchment polygon in this raster has the value of its maximum flow path. And then we can use a comparison operator where we say that the drainage distance equals the maximum flow path, and that will be Boolean true, and the rest will be Boolean false. And I call the result max flow path pixels. So this gives us exactly the cells that have that maximum flow path, so the source of that. And from that, I can route towards the outlets of these subcatchments. So you see here, this is the source pixel, of the most upstream pixel of this subcatchment. And then when I use the path tool, I can give here the flow direction as LDD layer and this Boolean raster max flow path pixels, which are the locations of the maximum flow path. And I name the result longest flow paths. And when I run this, I get a layer with the maximum flow paths, as you can see here. Let's style it. I use paletted unique values, click classify, it's Boolean. And here I see in red the longest flow path per subcatchment. To see the divisions of the subcatchments, I'm going to move them to the top and change the styling to outline simple line. And now you see the borders of the subcatchments, and then in red, the longest flow path. Now that's all nice, but I would like to see it as vectors, as lines. And therefore I need to have only ones and not the zeros, but missing value. And the easiest way to do that is using the if then operation, where you say if the longest flow path is true, then give me back the longest flow path, and else give me back missing value. And I call this result longest flow path underscore no data. And I run it, you see that I will end up just with value 1. And then I can use the rthin tool from grass to thin this, which is necessary if we want to convert this to a vector. Thinning means that our raster will be at the end only 1 pixel wide. And I save the result to longest flow path thin.diff. Remember that if we use non-PC raster tools, we should not write it to the PC raster format, but to a geotiff. And here you see what the thinning does. And after thinning, I can convert this to vector using the r2vect tool. It's a line feature, and I can use the raster values as categories. Here now will just be value 1. And then I can save the result as a shapefile with the longest flow paths. Let's run it. And there's the result. Let's style it a bit. Good to use blue for rivers. And it will look nice with the shaded relief in the background. And I can make the polygons a bit thicker. And this is our final result. So in this video, you've learned how to create an attribute table of subcatchment polygons with attributes such as the average slope using zonal statistics, with the surface area, and with the maximum flow path. You've also learned how to visualize this maximum flow path. I hope this video was useful for you. Don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel if you want to receive more updates on these kind of videos.